Hey, Lewismadmax, I'm back after about a 3-week respite from YouTube. I've used the time to write, about a 3-page essay for my return video. We've had all these things come out that, you know, the human life expectancy has increased to 73 years and all this other stuff. I decided to write an essay about it. I've spent a couple days doing it. I got my tomatoes behind me, my corn, my eggplant, and all that. And hopefully that'll give me immortality, but it won't. Anyway, here it goes. Immortality has been at the top of the human wish list for all of our known history. Eternal life has only been humanity's great dream since the moment we became conscious. One of the earliest recorded poems, the Epic of Gilgamesh, takes it as its central focus. Gilgamesh, after the frightening death of his best friend, goes on a quest for the secret of immortality, and he finds it. It's a plant, but on the way back he loses it through carelessness, and that is why we don't live forever. In the biblical version, Adam and Eve get chucked out of the Garden of Eden. Not just because they ate of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and had sex with their eyes open and invented designer clothing. but because God's afraid they will eat from the tree of life as well and become one of Him and live forever. The ancient Greek version of mortality is more like the one in The Lord of the Rings. Humans are mortal beings, doomed to die because that is their nature. All animal forms with more than rudimentary complexity must die. Though they don't spend a lot of time pondering it, we, on the other hand, find the idea of dying, well, an affront. And we feel we are somehow entitled to an explanation. Perhaps that's because we invented human language, which pretty much includes not only the past tense, implying the question, where did we come from, but the future tense too, which leads inevitably to where are we going. We're also intensely fond of the personal pronoun I, a word that makes it almost impossible for us to think of ourselves as not existing. Even in the sentence, I will be dead, the ego is in some way still present. We can't, in thought, erase ourselves completely. And over time, we've provided many tracts of personal real estate for our future but no longer embodied selves, heavens and hells and purgatories, and fields of asphodel and paradises and limbos in a bewildering variety. Reminds me of the Sibyl of Cumae and the once handsome Tithonus. Both have very long life granted to them by the gods, but forget to ask for youth. As they slowly wrinkle up and shrivel away, they regret the length of their lives. Jonathan Swift's Shuttlebugs and Gulliver's Travels aside, suppose we could have extremely long lives, and youth, and beauty too. Would it make us better people? Or would it make us immoral monsters, like Oscar Wilde's Dorian Gray, he whose portrait does his aging for him? Or would we become wise but ruthless, like H. Rider Haggard's 2,000-year-old woman in She? Would we become wicked out of sheer boredom? Would endlessness equal pointlessness? Is the foreknowledge of death the salt that gives the savor of life? Perhaps we use our span of years to establish tyrannies, or corner the stock market, or turn the planet into one big golf course. Such musings were once merely speculative, but if any item appears so intensely desirable to us, chances are we will work tirelessly to get it. Immortality, once a property of the gods alone, now appears to hover just out of reach. Living longer and living more fully are not the same thing. That's what these old stories tell us. We'll grab the fountain of youth if we can. We'll guzzle down the water of life. Or most of us will. Others will side with William Blake. William Blake looked into and through time rather than ahead, along its endless trajectory. And whose wish was not to continue without end, but hold infinity in the palm of his hand, and eternity in an hour.